In 2012, money controls our elections and our legislation, and we now have government of, by, and for the 1%. This is the classic definition of plutocracy. It is plutocracy when money controls elections, legislation, and the law. And all this keeps increasing the gap between the 1% and the 99%. It is another form of government that responds only to money. The reason that the word plutocracy is here is part of the lexicon is that it means government by the rich. And in 2010, we now have unlimited corporate contributions to campaign authorized by the Citizens United decision. Foreign wealth to influence U.S. campaigns is no longer illegal, or at least the Supreme Court says we don't have to report it, so we don't know if it's coming in, which is, I think, a more accurate way of stating it. Disclosure legislation that would have told us where that money was coming from and how much corporate contributors were contributing was fought off by Senator Mitch McConnell in the last legislative session in the Senate. And that disclosure legislation had 59 votes in favor of it. There was a substantial majority, but you had to have a supermajority, and a supermajority McConnell was able to block. People like Meg Whitman, who's a candidate for governor in California, who spent more than $160 million of her own money. In the House in this last election, Michelle Bachmann raised $11 million and spent more than $8 million of her own. Former World Wrestling Entertainment CEO Linda McMahon spent nearly $47 million in her candidacy for the Senate in Connecticut. And candidate Sharon Engel in Nevada raised $21 million, and Barbara Boxer spent $22 million. And when you're trying to think of the significance of all of this, and you're trying to imagine living on the west side of Santa Fe, or in Harlem in New York, or the west side or the south side of Los Angeles, and you're aware that these amounts of money are going into campaigns, and you're told you can vote. You can vote. You've got a vote. About two-thirds of the United States senators were millionaires in 2008, according to a recent analysis of politicians' fortunes conducted by the Center for Responsive Politics. In the Senate, 68 legislators were estimated to be worth at least $1 million, 68 out of 100. The average net worth across the Senate was $13 million. This is a Senate which is likely to be responsive to interests of a certain kind and less responsive and less knowledgeable and less intuitively and sympathetically, emotionally in touch with people who can't get health care because of a pre-existing condition, or people whose schools are, for whom their schools are inadequate, or people who find that the bridges are going out and the roads are going out and the way they want to belong to a union, and the national campaign of the media is that unions are doing us in because of their benefits. When does the government become a government on behalf of the wealthy? And when does the government cease to be a democracy on behalf of the whole of the people? Well, this is Chief Justice Roberts. When he testified before the Senate, he said that his net worth was $6 million, including $1.6 million in stock holdings. He's got an additional salary of $217,000 a year. So the probability that Justice Roberts will be emotionally connected to the people who come to his court seeking standing to contest health care legislation, the possibility that people who are so well off will feel emotionally connected to people who can't get to the hospital, can't afford to get to the hospital, can't afford the ambulance, is less than it would be if there was less income inequality. I've been, as we have all been in this last set of weeks, we've been asking ourselves questions about the nature of the conversation going on in this country today, the nature of the small talk, the nature of the accusations, the nature of the pettiness, the nature of the power struggle, and the way in which money has absolutely dominated that struggle, the way in which money has been used in super PACs to control and direct the kind of things we talk about, to direct our agenda, to control our sense of the story that we're living or what we're not living. And we're all being told by one set of conversations that poor people are poor because they're lazy, and we're being told by another set of conversations that rich people are rich because they're smarter than the rest. And all of that runs against the grain somehow. And yet we've not put together, in the largest part of a campaign, we're unable to put together the systematic analysis of how we got to be where we are and who we are and what the role of democracy is and the role of its opposite. And its opposite is government by those who have the most money. We're faced with this confrontation of global money, of global governance in boardrooms that we cannot see and hear and listen to or participate in. This global governance is spreading without democracy, and it's spreading in part because of our inability to fight back chapter and verse. And so this little slideshow that we're going to see is a part of a chapter and verse. We'd like to put together a series of pieces of information for you so that you can go wherever you want to go, and you can speak with authority about the way in which government of the people, by the people, and for the people is in great jeopardy. In 2007, only 20% of us owned 85% of all our wealth. The remainder of us, 80% of us, owned only 15%. Just imagine that. Just imagine. Try to think of the images that that brings to mind. It could be imaged this way. If there were 100 people living in this community and we owned 100 houses, 20 of those people would own 85 of those houses. And all the rest of us would be stuffed into the last 15. That's the condition in America today. Jobs should be cut, people should work longer, and we should give up our right to Medicare and Social Security so that people can live in this manner. That one American family can own approximately more than 100 million others. It has an effect on us, and we'll see the effect it has, and it's not a benign effect. It's not just okay to have this huge gap. It's not just all right for a community as a whole. It has consequences. This is the bonus. This is a scale of bonuses. $90 billion is the bonus allowance the top five Wall Street firms gave to their top employees in 2010. $90 billion. That's more bonus than the GDP of this whole list of 13 countries. They wonder why we raise the question about equality. And when we raise the question about equality, the word is thrown at us that maybe we're socialists or we might even be communists. But the word equality has been driven from our vocabulary for a reason. It's being driven from our vocabulary because they don't want us, those who do the newspaper writing and the filmmaking and the television, don't want us to notice that the richest are getting those big houses, are getting that legislation because they have this excess income left over that they don't have to pay taxes on. Altogether, the 400 richest Americans, whose total wealth exceeds the combined wealth of the bottom 150 million, the 400 richest, whose total wealth exceeds that of 150 million at the bottom, are paying an average income tax of only 17%. And unless we reverse it with campaign finance reform, unless we reverse it with amendments to the Constitution, unless we reverse it by participating in the legislative hearings going on right now, unless we take a stand and get into it and allow ourselves to ride the driftwood down the river, the driftwood will carry us out to sea and democracy will be passed. The Koch brothers plan to spend $88 million on conservative causes in 2012. $88 million is a fair amount of money. And so here we get to the money that controls lobbying. This is an incredible figure. During the healthcare debate in 2009, the health industry spent $1.4 million a day lobbying the Congress. The natural gas industry spent $750 million in 2005 in order to persuade the Congress to exempt fracking from the Clean Water Act. The Supreme Court has ruled over and over in recent times that money equals speech and corporate speech is protected for oil, tobacco, chemicals, coal, pharmaceuticals, Wall Street, and banking. But there is another way in which most of us have lived. We're talking about civilization here. the civil in civilization. We're not just talking about a form of government. We're talking about the larger issue of what is civil and how do we preserve and maintain and increase what is civil in our culture. When we come together like this, we are a team. And when we move out with a program like this, as we hope to do, we'll be going out as teams. We'll be going out not to carry just the message of the evil of plutocracy, but more the message of the beauty of the human spirit, more the message of what we can do together when we need to do in an emergency, more the message of how we were born to cooperate, and we know how to do that, and nobody can tell us we don't. And that's the kind of government we want to have. We want to have a government that reflects that whole human being, that whole human spirit, reflects the culture and capacities of every one of us, affects the cultures and capacities of the poorest of us economically and the poorest of us in spirit, those who are beaten down by foreclosures, those who are beaten down by unemployment over the months and years. It is that spirit that we want to revive. It is their hope that we want to revive. It is their possibility that we want to revive. We are not against corporations just because they're big. We're against corporations when they are soulless. And let's hitch our wagon to history. Let's remember those who've led us in nonviolence before. Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Cesar Chavez. And never forget that in this long sweep of the last 1,000 years, it has become increasingly apparent that government by the people, for the people, and of the people is eventually inevitable. We are in the tide of history. We're losing right now, but we've been gaining over the last 700 years, and we will gain, and we will win. That's inevitable. So let's remember a little piece of Abraham Lincoln and the Gettysburg speech.
That this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from the earth.
But we are people here. We are people here. We are people here.